Welcome and thank you for joining us today. We're thrilled to be discussing the email evolution. The exciting part of digital marketing is that the landscape is always changing. It's been a while since email was greatly affected by any change, so it's about time some new features are becoming available. Today we'll cover some tips to help ensure your email campaigns are staying ahead of the curve. Today we have our two email experts with us. We have Monica DiBartolo, the email marketing director at Jellyfish, and Skip Federa, the director of client services for DotMailer. I'll let them both introduce themselves. Monica, why don't we start with you?
Great, thanks Katie. And hello everyone, thank you for joining. I'm Monica DiBartolo, the email marketing director here at Jellyfish. We are a full-service digital marketing agency, and we have a global presence with nearly 300 employees and offices in the U.S., U.K., and South Africa. We provide a variety of services including paid search, SEO, social media, analytics, creative and development, and of course, email. I bring over 15 years of experience in direct and digital marketing, having led the creation and execution of strategic and successful email campaigns for a variety of clients in industries such as large pharma, financial services, retail, and e-commerce. Skip?
My name is Skip Federa, and I'm the client services director here at DotMailer. You may have guessed by the accent that I'm not originally from London, but I've been based here for 15 years. DotMailer is the UK's largest email service provider, and we provide services to clients big and small around the globe, from clients as big as DHL, so we're the global email service provider, but we can also handle the other end of the market. We happen to have, as a client, the largest chicken coop manufacturer in all of Wales. In addition to that, I've been in the email marketing industry. I've been in marketing for over 20 years, in the email industry for, probably over 20 years now, which is a little depressing to think about. Working with clients such as HP, Dell, Odeon Cinemas, and the like. I'm also the chair of the Email Marketing Council here in the UK, the UK DMA, and a member of the board of directors of the Direct Marketing Association as well. Really excited about the webinar for today.
Great. So today, Skip and I will be covering several interesting topics, including how email is alive and thriving, the importance of marketing automation, the mobile experience, deliverability and ideas that go beyond the inbox, and some tips for list growth. We will then summarize everything into a quick reference guide for you, and we will open it up for questions. If you have questions along the way, feel free to type them into the chat. So, jumping right in. Email has had a bad rap in the past, and I know when I tell people I do email marketing for a living, and I'm sure maybe you've had a similar experience, their immediate response has been, oh, so you're the one that spams me? And I think that that knee-jerk reaction is going to begin to change. Studies indicate that people are becoming more and more accepting of email and more comfortable with opt-in management. With the use of marketing automation strategies, email communications are becoming more relevant and timely, aiding in the wider acceptance. A few quick tips to make the most of your current strategies are: use your own data for benchmarks. Industry benchmarks are nice to reference, but what we don't know is the segmentation and cadence associated with those benchmarks. To really make a difference in your marketing efforts, focus on improving your own stats week over week, month over month, and year over year. The next one is to find your cadence sweet spot. Study your cadence limits and take a look at your segment performance and test the opt-out threshold by quantity of messages, your message frequency, and when fatigue begins to set in. And of course, make sure you're using a clean list. Maintaining a clean and engaged list is important both from a deliverability perspective and marketing automation. If you don't have one already in place, building a re-engagement campaign for anyone that hasn't engaged in a while should be the next campaign you tackle. Remove the people who haven't engaged recently from your other campaigns until they become active again.
These are the most recent stats from the UK DMA, Monica, and they align nicely with stats that I've seen from the US. As you can see, email is the most popular channel for consumers across all age groups, so this notion that email is dead is completely and utterly false. And, you know, every time I hear, ooh, this channel is going to kill email, I just don't believe it. It's just not true. I think what we're seeing is that while it's undeniable that younger people do not use emails to communicate with their friends and to communicate with their social groups, their friends, their family, whatever. You know, brands aren't friends. Brands aren't in that inner circle. And email is the channel they want to use, that they choose to communicate with those brands.
Great. Skip, I agree that the numbers are also in line with what we're seeing in the U.S. And as mentioned before, email is definitely gaining in popularity overall. So my opinion for the main driver, as I also mentioned, is the marketing automation. So marketing automation helps drive more timely and relevant content. And because it's more timely and relevant, our email recipients are less likely to think that the emails they're receiving are spammy. That said, marketing automation is here to stay. It's going to continue to shape our marketing strategies for the future, and it has been around some time but really hit its stride in recent years. Simply put, marketing automation is the art of planning ahead and setting up campaigns to run automatically based on predetermined triggers. However, marketing automation goes beyond just email. You can drive individualized experiences on your website and in email with dynamic content that carry the same message throughout your retargeting efforts. By analyzing behaviors and engagement of your customers, you can determine where to start and focus your efforts. By putting your customers at the core of marketing efforts, you can begin to build strategies that will talk to them and meet their needs.
Exactly, Monica. And, you know, I think the thing for me is it's all about having human conversations at scale. And that is the focus of what we like to call the downstream automation. So, in reality, all automation or all downstream automation is based off an event. But in order to keep them straight, kind of make it easier to talk about, you know, marketers tend to put them into three buckets. The first one is date triggers. Date triggers either happen on an anniversary of an event or a fixed amount of time before or after an event, such as 30 days after a purchase or 9 days before a departure on a holiday. And I know I said that all triggers can be tied to events, but event triggers elicit an immediate response, such as a purchase confirmation, a thank you message after somebody's given you some data, that kind of thing. Now, behavioral triggers. Behavioral triggers are where it starts to get really, really interesting. This is where your email program recognizes your reader's digital body language and responds automatically. Just like we do when we have a face-to-face conversation. If the person we are talking to has their arms crossed, they're not making eye contact, they're looking around, maybe looking over our shoulder, we naturally as humans change the subject, lean in, try to engage them. Conversely, if the person is already leaning into the conversation, maintaining eye contact, you know that they're interested in what you're saying, and you'll keep saying it. You might even say it a little bit louder to see if you can draw some other people into the conversation. And what automation does is allow us to do this with each of our customers individually and at scale. It's easy to have a conversation with 1, 10, or even 100 of your customers. But when you start talking about having a conversation with 1,000, 10,000, or 100,000 customers, you know, that can't be done manually. That's got to be done through some sort of automation. Now, most of the time when we talk about marketing automation, we think about the downstream automation. We think about all these triggers and all the different ways that we can react to what our customers are doing and give them the best next message. But don't forget about upstream automation. Now, some people don't consider this automation. Some people consider this more administrative automation. But this is automation that allows you as the marketer to deliver a much richer message at one and one that you could never deliver manually. Let's look at some examples. So the first one is personalization. Now, personalization is an age-old direct marketing technique. But in an email environment, personalization is more than just "Dear Skip" or "You bought X product." Personalization is more about recognizing each recipient as an individual and tailoring the message directly for them. You can never send an email to the same customer twice because while they have the same name and the same email address, they've moved on. They've changed. Ideally, the previous message that you sent them changed them. It gave them something more to consider or drove them further down the purchasing funnel. So we have to remember that every time we send an email, we are really sending it to a new person, at least a different person, They may know more about us, but they are in a different place, and we have to be able to react to that. Now, we're going to talk about dynamic content in more detail in a second. So I'm going to park it for now, other than to kind of give a little bit of a definition of the way we think about dynamic content. Personalization tends to be taking data from the database and using that to populate the message or to help frame the message. But dynamic content is really around using an attribute, either a behavioral attribute or a stated attribute, job title, for example, gender, and determining what content a person gets from that. So there's an age-old cliche in direct marketing about getting the right message to the right person at the right time. And, you know, it is a cliche because it's true, and that's where cliches tend to come from. Now, obviously, downstream automation helps with the right time part of the of an individual message. But scheduling does the same thing for bulk messages. So whereas downstream automation tends to be very one-to-one, an individual has done something and we've reacted, scheduling allows us to do the same kind of thing, but with you know, more generic messaging. So sometimes, you know, the right time is not a time when you want to be working, such as Black Friday or Christmas Day. So set the campaign up in advance, schedule it to go out when it needs to go out, and then, you know, check in, make sure it went, monitor results. But it's a lot more fun to look at your email results while sitting around with the family, maybe watching a little bit of football or, you know, having that second glass of wine, than it is to drop everything you're doing and trundle into the office on a Christmas afternoon. Last but not least is re-mail. Now, this should probably not come as a shock to anybody on this webinar, but your recipients are not sitting by their computers desperately waiting for your emails to arrive. If they have not opened it after a few days, they most likely have missed it, and they're not going to go looking for it. Do them a favor. Send it again. You sent it for a reason. You sent it because it was a relevant message for them. It was something that they wanted, and they've missed it. So go ahead and send it again. So I want to talk about some of these concepts in reference to a case study or in the frame of case study. So let me say a little bit about FairFX. FairFX is an online-only currency exchange. Now, currency exchange, as you can imagine, is a very competitive market with some traditional gorillas in each territory. American Express kind of being the global gorilla across everything. So the problem that you have in this space is there are very small margins. The way you make money in currency exchange is you buy it in bulk and you sell it at retail, and you're making a slim little bit on the different rates that you get. FairFX has a prepaid currency card, so you can buy the currency in advance, have it charged up to this card, it's a MasterCard, and then take it on vacation. It gives you all the benefits of a MasterCard. So, you know, if it gets lost or stolen, you can stop the card, you can get it replaced, you don't lose your money. It's more widely accepted than traveler's checks. The problem is a lot of consumers didn't understand the product. They got the card, they go away on vacation, they give the card to the hotel, and the hotel will put a block on a huge amount of the money that was on the card, thereby not leaving them any to spend. And this generated loads of calls to the call center, lots of frustration. So what FairFX wanted to do was they were trying, ultimately, to use automation to deliver a much better customer experience. So what did they do? So they used some website tracking software to identify the email addresses and the people associated with those email addresses who had been to their FAQ page. They then reacted to anybody who left the FAQ page with an abandoned browse kind of email. Basically, hey, you left the FAQ page after a very short time. Did you not find what you were looking for? Or if they'd gone to a number of pages but only spent a brief time in each page, you know, did you not find what you're looking for? And if the person did in the email say, no, I didn't find what I was looking for, they were taken to a survey, which you can see here. The survey then basically said, what were you looking for? It allowed the customer service people to respond, somewhat proactively, but also to control that flow of outbound traffic. But it also gave the web team more information to add to the FAQ page. What they saw after implementing the solution, so 91% of all inquiries were dealt with in the first month. In other words, 91% of all the information needed was added to the FAQ in that first month after, each month after that. It was just a small amount of incremental information that needed to be added. In other words, it was just a small number of people who didn't get the information they wanted. They were able to do this, but not increase headcount during their peak period, which was critical for them, so it was cost savings. They provided a better customer experience, so they met their first two objectives. But what they also found was a five-figure incremental income that was totally unexpected, and it ended up being more effective than many of the cross-sell programs they had running at the time. So a completely unexpected result, but a very positive one.
Great. Skip, this is a terrific example of how to use dynamic content. And so essentially, for dynamic content, the actions of the users are captured and visitors are targeted based on either their demographic or behavioral metadata within a specific time frame. They then receive dynamic and automated content based on the rules that are put in place. For those that may not know the difference between data-driven content versus behavioral content, think of an example that we just went through, and now think of when you have first name in your database and you can dynamically pull first name into your email. The first name dynamic insertion is data-driven, while providing content based on interest and engagement is behaviorally driven. Though it's still important to utilize the data that you have on your database, it is becoming more important to collect information about the content your customers are interested in, based on their behavior with your site and engagement with prior emails. This information will allow you to deliver communications that support their interest. Another aspect of behavioral targeting is making sure your messages can be consumed via any device, because let's face it, in today's world, mobile can't be ignored. It's been reported that the most popular activity on a smartphone is email, and 75% of smartphone users delete emails that they can't read. Additionally, 53% and growing of email readership is taking place on mobile. Therefore, responsive design is strongly recommended. And here at Jellyfish, we build emails responsively as a standard. As a side note, there is a big push for businesses to support mobile experiences from a site perspective in April 2015. This is when Google's SEO MobileGeddon launched. Google updated their algorithm to take the mobile experience into consideration when delivering mobile search results. This further proves that the industry is ready, wanting, and expecting their mobile experience.
Monica, I agree. I've seen all kinds of stats that drive this point home. People check their phone anywhere from 85 to 200 times a day, which, due to the math, works out to be anywhere from 11 minutes or much, much less. The average consumer is never more than 4 feet away from their phone, except, all these stats just fly everywhere. I would caution, however, that a responsive template is not a silver bullet. I've definitely got clients who have increased their overall ROI through increases in conversion rate and average order value and repeat purchase, but I have never seen a study that across the board everybody who's implemented a mobile template has seen such positive results. So results do vary, and if you've got other things on the plate, you got to use that as consideration. But that caveat aside, let's go through a few things here that we tend to think about with clients when we're going to go approach mobile. Most data indicates that currently the mobile device is being used to triage email. As payment and form journeys become better on mobile devices, you will increasingly see this shift so that more emails are actioned fully in the mobile and it's a truly mobile journey. But this currently is not the case. At least it's not what we're seeing with our clients. We have to put a lot of attention on the inbox to ensure that our emails get opened, triaged positively, in other words, not deleted, not swiped, and deleted straight away, and get referred back to at some other time later in the journey. The first thing to remember is that people may be looking at their inbox in two different formats on the same mobile device. For example, I tend to use the Gmail client if I specifically go into the phone to check personal email, but if I'm checking my work email, then I might pop into my Gmail account in the iPhone's native email client. On top of that, the native mobile inboxes are configurable, so make sure you check in each option. Now, I've not seen any data on how many people actually do configure their inbox, so you probably have to go with the default, but you want to make sure that you check your email in all the variations just to make sure it doesn't look bad. So regardless of which app the recipient uses to look at the email, your from name is the first thing they're going to see. So make it clear who is sending the email. Use the brand name that the recipient will recognize, but make it short enough for it all to be visible. You want to appeal to their system one or automatic responses, right? You don't want the recipient to have to think about who you are. You just want them to be like, yep, there's this email's from, need to deal with it later. The other thing is, email is a two-way communication channel. You know, using do not reply is the email equivalent of talk to the hand. It's just rude. The next thing the recipient will see is a subject line. Again, this needs to be short enough to be read. We tend to use four words as a rule of thumb, but don't be a slave to this. Rather than fixating on the number of words, remember to give the subject line the dedicated time it needs to be really, really good. It needs to be brilliant. It should not be an afterthought. Finally, you've got the preheader text. And this is the first HTML text in the email and should be used as an extension of your subject line. So you're going to want to keep it short and snappy. Think of it almost as a tweet. What you don't want to do is have any admin links show up, like unsubscribe, can't read, add to save sender, etc. And I'll show you an example of this in just a second. When thinking about mobile, it's important to remember that the device has a completely different form factor. So I was speaking to the creative director of an agency who actually won the UK DMA Awards for email. They won the gold medal for the email category. And it was an email for a large cable company. And he was saying his agency always designs for the mobile first. Their view is, if it looks good on mobile, it'll look good on the desktop. And so in this email from John Lewis, you can see exactly that's what they've done here. The larger button is obvious. The larger button and the obvious call to action works well in the mobile version on the left, but it obviously works well in the desktop version, which is on the right. They then optimized the rest of the design for the different formats. The nav bar in the mobile version has been tweaked to display the relevant links to the mail recipient. And following on from that, what we've just discussed, they have removed the admin links at the top of the email. On the desktop version, admin links are there, and you can see the nav bar, the full nav bar is visible. Part of the design for mobile first is thinking about the context of the recipient when they are reading email. You know, when you're reading an email on your mobile device, you're likely to be either out of the house on the go or time crunched, you know, slipping in a couple of emails between meetings, that kind of thing. In either case, ease of use is paramount. One of the most overlooked features is click to call. You should not be putting a phone number into an email if you don't want people to use it. And I'm going to throw up, you know, I'm going to air some dirty laundry here. As you can see from our signature block on the left, our numbers are not recognized by click to call because we've got the plus sign in them and the zero. Whereas in the example on the right, the phone has recognized that that is a phone number and has made it clickable. And if you click it, you'll get the little pop-up that says call this number, and you hit call, and it's, you know, you're connected straight away. I mean, at the end of the day, it's called a smartphone for a reason. In the days before widespread broadband, we used to talk about keeping emails light. You know, don't have really high-res images. Don't have too many images. Make sure the email downloads quite quickly. And it's still a consideration because cellular bandwidth is just not consistent across the board. You also have to remember that people will be in places where they may not be connected. They may not have access to Wi-Fi. The mobile signal might not be strong enough. They may be commuting. They may be in a tunnel, whatever. So you have to think about, you still have to think about what your email is going to look like with images off. And in this example, what they've done is they've put a colored table behind the image, and they've styled their alt tags so that if you open the email with images off, you still know what it's about. It's not perfect, but it's better than just having empty boxes. The last thing to remember in mobile-first design is, and context, is to make your emails behave as closely as possible to the other apps that are already on the phone. You know, again, going back to that System 1 response, I don't want to have to think about it. I know how other apps work, and the email should work the same way. So in this example, turning the phone from portrait to landscape fills the screen with the video, just like if the person was in YouTube.
Great. Now that we've covered responsive design and some tips for the inbox, let's talk about getting to the inbox and then the ideas that go beyond. So for deliverability, just because you hit send on an email campaign, it doesn't necessarily mean that the message has been delivered or inboxed. There are hundreds of factors that can affect deliverability, but a few tips to help improve deliverability begin with your list. Making sure your list is clean and that the email addresses have been verified at least once in the last 6 to 9 months is important. By sending a list for verification, you will actually ping the address to determine if you have any invalid emails, spam traps, or disposable domains. By cleansing your list, you can improve the percentage of emails that make it to inbox and reduce your risk of being blocked by the ISPs. You also want to make sure that you have your digital handshake set up. This is the SPF and DKIM records. These pieces of information are implemented at the server side of your domain and essentially say, yes, this ESP has permission to send email on my behalf. It digitally lets the ISPs know that the emails you are sending are legit. You also want to keep an eye on your sender score. Your sender score is like a credit score for your IP address. It tells the ISPs how strong or poor of a reputation you have for sending emails. Along with these high-level tips, we have a few deliverability myths that Skip would like to bust for you.
Okay, so myth number one, sending plain text messages to subscribers is good for your deliverability, inbox placement rates, and open rates. I'm not sure which is more baffling, the fact that this myth was ever created or the fact that it just lives on and on and on. You know, in reality, sending a plain text email has zero effect on your deliverability. Meaning the plain text has zero bearing on the ability to pass your email off to any receiver or ISP. Plain text messages also have zero impact on your inbox placement rates. There are lots of factors that weigh into your ability to get into the inbox as opposed to the spam or bulk folders. Among them, as mentioned, are domain reputation, IP reputation, content, etc. But your email is HTML, just plain text, just isn't one of them. But the biggest part of this myth that needs to be busted is that emails composed in plain text receive better open rates than emails composed in HTML. I guess the idea or thinking here is if the email is in plain text, the ISP will pass it into the inbox because it looks like an email from a single individual. And once it's into the inbox, you know, people will open it because it's there. That logic is just faulty. You know, as Monica just explained, there's a whole handshake process and authentication process from your ISP to the receiving community, which means they know it's not a personal message. They know it's not from an individual, you know, before they've even had a chance to scan it for its content to see if it has HTML or it's plain text. So sending a plain text email doesn't by itself help your deliverability. But, that said, it may improve your engagement because sending a plain text email more closely represents what an account manager or salesperson would send, and people don't feel like they're being marketed to quite so much. So people may engage with your plain text email more, and therefore it works out to be better for you because the more engagement, the more inbox placement. But in and of itself, there's no causal relationship between plain text in inbox placement. And furthermore, if it's truly plain text, you can't tell if it was opened anyway, so you really don't know how engaged people are. The next next one is around engagement. And people talk about, you know, an open is good, but a click is better. And again, this is just not the case. So we sat down, our head of compliance and I and a bunch of others sat down with some of the largest in the email receiving community in the U.S., including Google, AOL, Yahoo, Microsoft. And we started talking about, you know, they wouldn't give us the exact algorithm. That would have been giving us the keys to the kingdom. But what we started asking about different things that our clients were saying to us, one of the things when we got to this one is they all pointed to their own privacy policies, which basically say they don't monitor clicks. They don't track where you go when you click from an email. That is part of their privacy policy with their users. So saying that, oh, somebody clicked is going to help my inbox placement, again, just not the case. And I mean, there are loads of myths that we could bust. We only have time for three, so I picked this one because this one is one that we get all the time. Subject lines should not exceed a certain length or should not contain special words or certain characters. And the easiest one, the easiest way to bust this myth, especially for an American audience, is think about the Super Bowl. Now, we just had Super Bowl 50. But 20 years ago, kind of when email was starting to come about, we had Super Bowl 30. And throughout the next decade, every Super Bowl had XXX in it because the NFL uses Roman numerals. Now, I know that obviously we didn't do those emails. The NFL would not come to a UK ESP to do that. But I do know the deliverability team at the company that did do those emails, and I can tell you they had no problem getting those emails delivered all the way through that decade. Similarly, I work with a cinema chain here or a movie chain here in the UK, and we had no trouble getting that Vin Diesel classic XXX delivered, right? And you would say, you'd have to think, wow, putting XXX in your subject line, that's got to get your emails blocked. Just not the case. If it was XXX and a bunch of other words that fall into the more XXX category and less of the NFL category, yeah, you might have a problem. But there is no silver bullet word or word or character set that will prevent your emails from getting delivered.
So once you make it to the inbox, there are now new things to consider thanks to Google and their new quick action email markups. By adding schema.org markups to your email coding, you can accelerate user actions in Gmail by highlighting the most important information from the email right into the inbox. These actions include RSVP, review, one-click actions, go-to, and flight actions. Inbox by Google has a few additional features that Gmail doesn't. You do have to go through a slight approval process with Google before being able to use these features, and these features may or may not make sense for your emails, but it's good to know how the landscape is evolving and what your emails are competing against for attention. As of now, these quick action features are only offered by Google, but as we've seen with many other things Google does, we can guess that the other ISPs aren't far behind, though nothing's been confirmed yet. Even further beyond the inbox, you can use your list to create social lookalike audiences for retargeting in social and gain additional insights about who you have in your database and what their interests are. We also suggest writing email content that focuses on keywords. Similar to an SEO experience, users can now search on their smartphone, so you want to optimize for this feature. This way your emails will be easily recalled.
Monica, you said it at the open and reiterated there with the Google example. It's so exciting to once again be able to start to talk about new innovative things in email as opposed to every couple of months having another feature taken away from us. It's just a really exciting time to be in email. In terms of extending outside of your email realm and leveraging your email program to do that, you know, I mentioned before the movie chain that we work with, Odeon Cinemas, and this is a case study of how they do this on a real regular basis. So, I mean, everybody's been to the movies, right? So you kind of understand what that experience is like, but you can also imagine that in a lot of key markets, you know, it's a very competitive space. It's not uncommon to have one multiplex across the street from another multiplex. It's also a unique retailing challenge because once a week, usually on a Thursday night, it's sort of like if you ran a shop and somebody came into your shop, stripped out all of your products, replaced some of them with new products, put some of the old ones back, put them in a different place, and you came in Friday morning and you had to start marketing that and selling that. The problem that Odeon had is there are 63 million people in the United Kingdom living in 26 million households, but they only have a database of about 4 million. What they really need is more bums on seats. So the way they did that is they've got a really, really good algorithm that will predict if a individual should want to see any particular movie. So they run this algorithm that's called the film correlation model, and they take the output of the film correlation model, and that's who they most heavily market any particular movie to. They can tie that then in with Facebook, because what they do is they use that the output of the film correlation model to build a Facebook custom audience, and they, in the initial weeks of the release, they use that as an exclusion. They don't want to be marketing to those people on Facebook because that costs a lot more money than marketing to them via email. And they should want to go see the movie anyway, so you know they've got a high likelihood that they'll go even without marketing. What they're looking for on Facebook, though, is the social graph around that population. The theory being that people tend to associate with like people, and therefore, if I am going to want to go see a film, my friends are going to want to go see the same film. And so they promote it that way. Then towards the end of the run of the movie, if I haven't gone and seen the film, they reverse the process. And they do use me as an inclusion. Because obviously email didn't work, so now we've got to try to get to them in a different way. By doing this, you know, this is the example from The Fault in Our Stars, but you know, they've done this over and over and over again. But they expanded their high propensity audience by about 400% for this particular film. They were able to do that with only 1.5 ad impressions per audience member, and 6% of all those impressions drove unique traffic to the website. The return on investment for that was over 406%. You know, and so linking in email with your other channels, I like to talk to people about specifically about search. You know, you should know your keyword strategy, your company's keyword strategy, and put those keywords in your subject line, in your body copy. Because as you said, when those words will be remembered when somebody goes to look for your product. So they may have received your email. They may not have even opened your email. But that doesn't mean that that email is not helping drive traffic to your website.
Skip, that's a great case study. I really love hearing stories of successful cross-channel marketing, and that, I think, really tells it. So to further the discussion of beyond the inbox, we do want to talk about list growth. And this seems to be a burning question for many marketers. How do I grow my list? So we would like to suggest working with other channels to help drive traffic to your site. But once they're on your site, how do you get them to sign up? One way we suggest growing your list is to incorporate light boxes or popovers on your site. You can choose to have this appear as soon as someone enters your site for the first time or after they browse around a bit. You'll want to really figure out what your strategy there is. And it's also important to set expectations of why someone would want to submit their email address. Let them know what's in it for them. You can provide exclusivity of news or offers, or provide an offer with purchase. And while we're on this topic, I'd like to also call out a major list growth don't, which is don't use third-party lists or an old list that you come across and don't know what it's for or how it was generated. You don't really want to borrow lists or buy lists either. Lists that aren't current and active in a source directly generated by and related to your brand will not perform well and are more likely to flag you as spam and not engage. This will have a negative impact on your deliverability and sender score. And most of you listening today are probably saying, duh, I already knew this, but it can be new news to new email marketers, and it's always good to be reminded of things that we already know.
I can't echo that sentiment enough. First off, most of the ESPs that you would deal with, if you have a purchase list, that violates their terms and conditions. They will not send that. And then, you know, it happens all the time. We get marketers that upload it, a purchase list, and we say, well, we're not going to send that. And they say, oh, I didn't realize it was purchased. And, you know, they look a little bashful. The reality is it will seriously damage your deliverability. They don't tend to work very well. There's lots of other ways to go about it. And so here's a case study from one of our clients about, so Barbour, I'm sure everybody's heard of the Barbour jacket. Interesting problem they had. So they were founded in 1894, but they've only started selling direct and selling online, I want to say in the last two and a half years. So they were going from zero. They were going from no list at all. So some of the challenges they faced were, how do we are a luxury brand, and how do we deliver that luxury brand experience online? Loads of people have Barbour jackets. There's literally hundreds of thousands of people around the globe who are brand advocates, but Barbour doesn't know who any of them are because they had no real database. So they tried a number of techniques, and we finally kind of convinced them to go with the popover lightbox approach. You know, I've asked hundreds of marketers at different presentations all over the place, you know, how many people like popovers? And, you know, show of hands. I've only had like three or four people ever raise their hand. Nobody really likes them. They feel they're a bit too pushy. They feel they're a bit too salesy. But you can't get around the fact that they work. So Barbour did implement the popover after testing some alternatives. There was a very, very carefully crafted welcome program that followed the popover. So again, using some marketing automation to walk people through a multi-step journey with decision nodes so that you took different pathways depending on how you interacted with the welcome program. They implemented some basic segmentation based on the explicit data that they collected. So again, trying to add relevance really straight away. And then they also drove people to a preference center. I think the key is on strategy is there is no one-size-fits-all strategy around how you use a pop-up or a lightbox on your website. You know, there's definitely no one-size-fits-all strategy across multiple businesses, but there's not even a one-size-fits-all strategy for a specific site. So think about what people are doing, where they've come from, and where they are. If somebody has searched for a specific product on Google and has landed on a deep link in your site, they're on a product page, they're probably ready to buy, and they're going to give you the email address as part of that journey anyway. So you just want to make sure you optimize that journey to collect the email address up front, so if they do abandon the basket, you can do an abandoned basket program to them. In other places, if you're about to ask for some information, we have this problem on our site. There are certain pages where we're asking for information. Again, we don't want the popover to appear. Unless the person is exiting that page without having given us the details, then maybe we do want it to appear. So you really, really need to think about it from your customer's perspective. How are they going to interact, or how are they going to react to having this thing pop up? And is it going to be a positive or negative experience for them? In the Barbour example, the results were pretty staggering. So in the 3 months before we piloted a popover, they collected 1,200 email addresses. In the 3 months after, they collected 20,000 new email addresses. The total sales from those emails grew by over 600%. So it's really important to look at your source so you can start to measure the effectiveness of different sources of data. The click-to-open rate was over 30%. The unique open rate was over 40%. And some of their campaigns that was sent to this new data set was generating six-figure revenue income, at six-figure revenue on a base of 20,000. That's pretty staggering.
All right. Well, with that, we've covered quite a bit today, and as promised, we have a quick reference guide for you. So this reference guide is a quick summary for you to pin up on your wall and reference to remind you of all the great bits of knowledge we've covered today. Please use this guide to help improve your campaigns. We are going to switch gears a bit now and answer some of your questions. So if you haven't done so already, please use the chat feature to send us your questions. Katie, our moderator today, will read us your questions, and we'll try to do our best to get through all of them. If we don't cover yours, or if you'd like to speak offline, please feel free to reach out to us. by emailing email@jellyfish.net.
Thank you, Monica and Skip. That was really informative and very helpful. We do have a handful of questions that came in, so I'm going to go ahead and get right to it. The first is, what data do we have to validate the effectiveness of re-engagement campaigns? And what is an example of a re-engagement rate for subscribers exposed to one of these campaigns?
Great. That's a really good question. And I would say that if you're starting a re-engagement campaign, you want to use your own data to really measure the people that you're reaching out to. Are they newly opening your emails again? Are they engaging? And really measure what their lifetime value is so that you can, you know, see how it's progressing for you. Skip, would you add to that?
Yeah, I agree. I think the one thing that I know is really, really hard for marketers to get past, usually the finance department, is have a holdout. And with re-engagement, it's pretty easy to have a holdout. So take some people and say, okay, they should be in the re-engagement pot, but I'm not going to put them in there. And then put some people through your re-engagement program and look at the difference. And that will, A, tell you the effectiveness. It also helps you build a really solid case study for why there might need to be more investment in re-engagement. And I think the other thing to watch out for is the definition of engagement. So we like to, when we talk to clients about engagement, we look at it two ways. We talk about engagement, which is interaction with the email. But we look to also talk about active and inactive, and that is engagement with the brand, usually through a purchase, but if, depending on your website, maybe it's a login or whatever. So someone who is getting your emails, not opening, not clicking, but is active with the brand, so they're purchasing, they're logging in, they're interacting with the brand, they may be, you know, your emails may be effective. They may be driving people to do that. They're just not opening and clicking. Now, there are some, you know, deliverability issues that could crop up because of that if that percentage gets to be too high. And, you know, there are some tricks around getting people to re-engage. The easiest one is just to say, you know, this is your last email if you don't open it, kind of thing, in the subject line, which is a bit harsh. I wouldn't go straight to that kind of nuclear option. But just because somebody's not opening or opening your email doesn't mean they're not actively relating with your brand.
Yeah, I'd just like to add, Skip, I think that was really great, and the call out of the halo effect that email can have. It, you know, it's really hard to measure that someone receives an email and then goes online without opening or clicking through your email, but we all know that it happens. So I know it's something that's hard to quantify, but making sure that you're checking that before you're calling somebody unengaged, you know, making sure that you really are checking the engagement with the brand beyond just email.
Yeah, and you can see that, you know, when you send out an email, you should see your search traffic go up, you should see your web traffic go up. You might even, you know, without getting too fancy about it, just ask some people that work on the shop floor, if you've got offline shops, you know, how often does somebody refer to an email when they come into the shop? And you'd be surprised that, you know, some of the stats I've seen in the UK is as many as 69% of consumers would go to a shop after seeing an email that was something that interests them.
Mm-hmm. Great. So we have another question here. You've spoken a lot about B2C marketing automation. How can we apply this to B2B, or are there specific B2B strategies that should be considered?
Yeah, so I think that most of what we're seeing here, we're talking about B2C because B2C has really come to market first and, you know, really does things faster than B2B, but all of these strategies can be applied to B2B and, you know, just be adjusted to meet your own marketing goals.
Yeah, I completely agree. You know, we talked about automation, so a very common B2C automation program is going to be an abandoned basket or abandoned browse. Obviously, if you don't sell online B2B, fine, but you've got forms, people are downloading content. You know, if they come to your form, they start to fill out the download form, don't complete it, treat that as an abandoned basket and follow up. The other interesting one is on the light box. There's a company here that I've seen some data from, a B2B company, and they were really, really reluctant to try a light box. They thought it was going to dramatically increase their abandon rate on their homepage. What they found was it increased it by less than a tenth of a percent, but it tripled their amount of registrations. So, you know, even something that seems quite salesy and quite consumery like a popover can work in B2B.
That's great. As far as list growth techniques, you mentioned light boxes. Are there any other techniques that work well that will improve your list size?
Yeah, so, I mean, I think that as far as list growth goes, when people are purchasing from you or downloading, you can collect their information then, so that definitely helps. Also, if somebody has purchased, you can send a follow-up email to, you know, sign up for more sales and promotions. You know, if they didn't opt in, you can send that as part of the receipt that they're getting. And then, as I just mentioned, from B2B perspective with that, if somebody's downloading something, you could require the email for download. Skip, do you want
to? Yeah, I think for the advice I give to clients is to generally, people do not come to your website to sign up for your newsletter. That's not the goal that they have in mind. Mm-hmm. So just having, you know, an email capture on your website, I wouldn't say take it off, but I wouldn't expect it to do particularly well because it's just not why people are there. But you need to go to wherever your leads, prospects, and consumers and customers are. So if you've got offline retail, you know, I've got a client that has done a really interesting thing. They started through the use of e-receipts. They're now collecting, obviously, email addresses at the point of sale in their retail shops. And for the first time, they're actually able to tie offline sales back to an email address and associate that back to an email without having to use some sort of offer mechanic or barcode mechanic or whatever. So just think about every place your business touches your customers or your prospects, and think about, is that an appropriate place to collect, you know, an opt-in for an email? Someplace like support or your complaints department, probably not. But, you know, customer service, field reps, salespeople, shop floor, you know, I've seen an airline in the U.S. did a thing where you texted in your email address using your phone, and they publicized this at baggage claim. So they knew they had a bunch of people standing in baggage claim, phones in their hands. Did you enjoy your flight today? If you sign, you know, send us your details, and we'll get you set up in the frequent flyer program straight away, kind of thing. So it's just being thinking a bit broader than, oh, I can only do it at the website.
Great. Well, thank you both so much. We're actually going to wrap up just a few minutes early, but thank you for sharing your email knowledge with us. We all really appreciate it. For those of you listening, if we didn't get to your questions, we'll follow up. We'll leave the chat open and you can continue to ask them, or you can go ahead and contact us at email@jellyfish.net. And thank you all for joining us today.